Those words live with me because I don't know if this brother understands, man. For him to speak like that is something that I will go to my grave with, man, because this is what we call one of the authorities of Black history, not just in England, not just in the UK, not just in Europe, but a worldwide authority. And we've been doing some work together, and I'm hoping that we continue that work together. I'm not too sure if the brother's going to go into the project. Our last time we met, I'm not sure if he's happy to go into that, but big things are going on behind the background, and I'm happy to be holding this brother's hand as we take this method on. Brothers and sisters of Hidden Truth Platform, can we please drop some ones for our king, Robin Walker, the Black History Man, the authority of Black history here in the UK. Drop some damn ones, man. Drop some damn ones and show some damn respect for this brother. Come on, my king. Robin, how you doing, king?
Life is good, sir. I'm really, really pleased to be here. And as ever, your show is fire. Big up to the scientist, Leon Marshall. And yeah, big things, big things, big things.
Big things. I'm going to hand over to you, my brother.
Okay. Can my screen be seen? And can I be heard? Is it coming through cool?
Yes, okay. We can hear you and see you, brother.
Okay, my presentation is going to be called Changing the Game, New Developments in Black History and African Heritage. And I have to thank everyone for lending me your ear and your concentration. I'll be talking for 50 minutes. I also have to thank the great man himself, the investigator. Very, very pleased to be here. And what you're doing is wonderful, wonderful work. And well, what's in it for you? Well, you're going to learn empowering information on Black or African history, detailed content that will expand your mind, and ideas and concepts that will increase your personal effectiveness as you triumph through life. Now, our topics for today are for me to talk about new teaching resources available for supplementary, primary, and secondary schools. Introducing www.theblacksecret.co.uk, the first online teaching resource for Black history and Pan-African heritage available all over the world, and new developments in African heritage. Let me get straight to it. When people think of Black history and African heritage, they rightly think of the mighty handful, the big five scholars, Professor Sheikh Anta Diop, Professor John Henry Clark, Professor Chancellor Williams, Professor Yusuf Yorkin, and Professor George Jackson. Then, of course, you've got all the brilliant work being done by the legendary Professor Ivan Van Sertima and his students, people like Wayne Chandler, Runoka Rashidi, and Charles Finch. And they're the people that produced splendid works such as African Presence in Early Asia, Black Women in Antiquity, Golden Age of the Moor, etc., etc. Now, these two groups of scholars inspired the Portland Model Baseline Essays. And what the Portland Model Baseline Essays did was to radicalize American school teaching beginning in 1987. And there's their website, the Portland Baseline Essays. Let me read the preface to it. Preface to the African American Baseline Essays: the Portland Public Schools Board of Education is committed to quality education for all students. Our school district is staffed by individuals who are committed to excellence in education. The African American Baseline Essays are but one part of a larger product to be developed to fulfill the Board of Education's goal to develop in all students a better understanding and appreciation of the history, culture, and contributions to society of different ethnic groups and cultures. And the result was they revolutionized the teaching of art, the teaching of English, the teaching of mathematics, the teachings of science and technology, the teaching of social science, and the teaching of music. And so what that meant was American schools now have the option to draw on the African-American baseline essays and infuse their curriculum with the content provided by the likes of Michael Harris, Joyce Braden Harris, Beatrice Lumpkin, Hunter Adams, John Henry Clark, and Charshi Lawrence McIntyre. Now, what I did was to take their findings and I radically updated these findings to produce these books. When we rule to update the teaching of history, African Mathematics, written with John Matthews, to revolutionize how we can Africanize the mathematics classroom. Black and Science, Volume 1, 2, and 3, to do the teaching of science and technology. Blacks and Religion are to do the same thing with RE teaching, and the Black musical tradition and early Black literature to do the same thing with the teaching of music and with the teaching of literature. Now, what's happened in recent years is very new material has become available for use in British schools. Candace Chimbiri has done her bit to revolutionize what can go on in a key stage 2 primary school classroom. My team has produced material for what can go on in a key stage 3 secondary classroom, and Tony Warner has produced material for what can happen in GCSE, the main exam for the 15 and the 16 year olds. Okay, now how is Candace Chimbiri changing the Key Stage 2 game, the primary school game?
London author wants to tell the youngest Londoners all about why they first came here and what they achieved through the eyes of the first ever Black mayor of Southwark. I'm delighted to say Candace Chimbiri joins me now. Thank you for coming in. Why this book and why now?
Well, I actually had the idea for the book last year, and I knew that this year was the 70th anniversary of the arrival of the Windrush in London, and I thought, why hasn't there been a children's book written about it before? So I decided to do it and bring it out this year.
Yeah, why did you target 7-year-olds and above?
Well, although there isn't a lot of literature, there is already literature for adults about the Windrush and the Windrush generation, but I didn't see any books for children. There have been very few, if any, over the last 70 years, even though it's considered a very important point in British history.
Does it help or hinder your work that obviously the Windrush generation have hit the headlines more recently again?
Yeah, well, I had the idea for the book before the scandal broke, and I wanted to tell the story the way I felt it should have been told over the last 70 years, as a positive story, and that's why I didn't mention the scandal in the book. And I'm glad that I did that now, because the feedback is that that was the right decision, and the feedback is that children now understand that Windrush is something to be celebrated. Yeah. It's not a bad news story.
I've just flicked through some of the pages, some of the nice descriptions of on board. All you had to do was mingle, talking about all the different nationalities that came together on the voyage, and one passenger remembering the voyage as a jolly occasion.
Robin?
Yeah.
Robin?
I think most people had a great time coming over. They had aspirations, they had great hopes. My parents came in the 60s, so they're part of the Windrush generation as well, coming from Barbados.
Yes, sir.
And they just wanted to make a better life for themselves.
Can you hear me?
See a bit of the world.
Yeah, the video's still going on. Yeah, just let you know, I'm not sure it's just my thing, but the video's choppy. I don't know if you press the two buttons. You know when you share screen?
Let me do that right now. Let me do that right now. I'm going to stop and restart, yeah?
Yes, sir. Yeah, we're on the share screen, the two little buttons at the bottom. Okay, brothers and sisters, the brothers is doing that now. We're going straight back into the presentation. You know it's going to be banging. And we're going to be going straight back where we left off.
Okay, let's try it again. All right.
An author wants to tell the youngest Londoners.
Is that an improvement?
Yeah.
Okay. An author wants to tell the youngest Londoners all about why they first came here and what they achieved through the eyes of the first ever Black mayor of Southwark. I'm delighted to say Candace Chimbiri joins me now. Thank you for coming in. Why this book and why now?
Well, I actually had the idea for the book last year, and I knew that this year was the 70th anniversary of the arrival of the Windrush in London, and I thought, why hasn't there been a children's book written about it before? So I decided to do it and bring it out this year.
Yeah, and why did you target 7-year-olds and above?
Well, although there isn't a lot of literature, there is already literature for adults about the Windrush and the Windrush generation, but I didn't see any books for children. There have been very few, if any, over the last 70 years, even though it's considered a very important point in British history.
Does it help or hinder your work that obviously the Windrush generation have hit the headlines more recently again?
Yeah. Well, I had the idea for the book before the scandal broke, and I wanted to tell the story the way I felt it should have been told over the last 70 years, as a positive story. And that's why I didn't mention the scandal in the book. And I'm glad that I did that now, because the feedback is that that was the right decision, and the feedback is that children now understand that Windrush is something to be celebrated. It's not a bad news story.
I've just flicked through some of the pages, some of the nice descriptions of on board. All you had to do was mingle, talking about all the different nationalities that came together on the voyage, and one passenger remembering the voyage as a jolly occasion.
Yeah, I think most people had a great time coming over. They had aspirations, they had great hopes. My parents came in the 60s, so they're part of the Windrush generation as well, coming from Barbados, and they just wanted to make a better life for themselves, see a bit of the world, and they were really positive people. Otherwise, they wouldn't have given up where they lived to come to a strange country.
And such a role model is the man who became the mayor of Southwark.
Yeah, Sam King. I mean, he passed away a couple of years ago, sadly, but I did hear him speak several times. And so he was a major inspiration for this book, because he actually came over on the Windrush, he fought obstacles, he overcame prejudice, and then he became the first black mayor of Southwark, which I thought was an amazing story.
Absolutely.
And one that children need to know more.
Yeah, and in terms of children knowing more, obviously it's a great stocking filler with Christmas coming up, but also is there any kind of plan to get the book into school so that teachers can use it as a resource?
Well, actually, teachers have already been using it. Surprisingly, they've been finding it using it for history, but they're also using it for reading and learning English and how to write. And they've also been using it for developing empathy, because they've been looking at the front cover and talking about how they think people might feel and how they might feel if they move from one place to another. So the front cover is already drawing the children in.
Brilliant. Job done already. Candace Chimberry, thank you so much for coming to talk to me about it. Good luck with the book. Thank you.
Thank you.
OK, so what literature has she produced? Well, step back in time to ancient Kush. The story of early ancient Egypt. For those of you that don't know, ancient Egypt is on the national curriculum, but most of the books don't tell the truth about ancient Egypt's African character. But this book does. And if you haven't got it already, it needs to be in your supplementary school, in your primary school, it needs to be there. Secrets of the Afrocone, tracing the history of 6,000 years of art and culture. And then the book that they were talking about on the news, The Story of the Windrush. Then the most recent book, The Story of Afro Hair, 5,000 years of history, fashion, and stuff. Again, these are books that have made it into the school system. And so if you're not aware of Candace Chimberi's work, now you need to get up to speed. Now, let me introduce one of my teams, Anthony Vaughan, Paula Perry, and of course, Vanika Marshall. Vanika Marshall is online, so, you know, shout yourself out. And these three did the research for a book called Black British History, Black Influences on British Culture, 1948 to 2016. And this book meets secondary school key stage three. Key stage three is what your 11 to 14 year olds does, and it meets the skill set and it meets the content exactly. And then we did a second book called 30 Black History Icons, 500 years of global Black influences, UK, USA, Europe, the Caribbean, and India. So what that means then is the combined work of my team and Candace Chimberi means we're able to get a lot of good content into the school system that tells our story. Now, Tony Warner has changed the GCSE game. He did a book called History, Migrants in Britain, and you can see his name there. He is one of the authors. Let's hear from him.
Tony Warner for Black History Wars. Give it up for Tony, thank you.
Testing, can you all hear me?
Yeah.
I used to live here back in the 80s, was a young man, so first of all, shout out to YMCA for giving me a place to stay when I was kind of struggling, because because it was a cheap place to stay back in the 80s. Yeah. When I was living here, there was a plaque to Harold Woody inside as he entered. And I was just impressed by the fact that this black man, Jamaican guy, was living here in the 30s and had his own civil rights group right here in England. Luther King came to prominence in America in 1955. He fought in America for equality in education, housing, employment, etc. Harold Moody did the same thing right here in this street in 1931, long before Luther King did this thing in America. So it's interesting to think that Luther King is actually on the curriculum, but Harold Moody is not on the curriculum. But at least now we have a recognition of his fantastic contribution, because when Harold Moody sets up the League of People here, he was not alone. In that group, people like Jomo Kenyatta, the first black leader of Kenya, he was actually in the group as well. People like Paul Robeson, the international superstar Paul Robeson, was also here as well. People like Leary Constantine, the world famous cricketer, was also here. So this place in this street was full of young black people who were all active to kind of fight for equality. So next time you walk down this street and you see a sign here, just remember Harold Moody, legendary civil rights activist right here in Britain in the 1930s, long before Luther King. And it all came up because people got together and put their money in their pockets. Took their money out of their pockets.
Okay, so what's in the book? Well, the skill sets that a GCSE student needs to exercise when they are doing history, that's in the book. Then you've got 16th century Africans. That's in the book. You also have your Oluda Equianos, your Ignatius Sanchos, your Ottoba Coguanos. You've got the revolutionaries like William Kufe. You've got the Bristol bus boycott, which was contemporaneous with the Dr. Martin Luther King's I Have a Dream speech. You have the Mangrove Nine political trial. So a lot of things then have happened with the changing of black history content and getting it to GCSE level. Now, the book isn't entirely black content. It's about one quarter black, one quarter Asian, one quarter Jewish, and one quarter all the other minorities. But it is a GCSE, and so that is a major, major shift. Now, what else has happened? Another one of my teams are revolutionizing adult Pan-African education, and we produced the Black Secret Education Project. And essentially, the Black Secret is a fundamental empowering concept. We are calling it quietly empowering the people. And we want to produce adults who can move themselves forward and the community forward. We want to engage people across the world with this program. You could be in London, you could be in Toxteth, Harlem, Kingston, Atlanta, Abuja, Nairobi, Accra. And we will do this in two ways. Our first way is through the Black Secret Education Project and through the Black Secret Business Project. So why is it called the Black Secret? Well, secrets empower those who know and disempower those who don't. And ultimately, Black history is still kept a secret. I'm doing my bit to bring it into the light. The investigator's doing the same thing. The scientist is doing the same thing. Tony Warner's doing the same thing. Candace Chimbiri's doing the same thing, and many, many others. However, there are people outside our community who do know our heritage, but have kept it quiet to empower themselves. Interestingly, the secret revealed principles of self-empowerment to the masses. Consequently, the Black Secret reveals empowering information on Black history and African heritage with the ultimate aim of empowering people, not just through our education project, which is the When We Rule course, but also through our business project. Now, the content is based on the book When We Rule. So for those of you that don't know, what's in that book?
I am a student of history, so I gotta recommend some history books, especially because it is Black History Month. When We Ruled by Robin Walker. This is one of the dopest books. Like, I promise you, this book is so bomb. It has color pictures in it, but the thing I love most about it, let me find it. It has a chronological order of all of the pharaohs from ancient Kemet. Check this out. This is so dope. I said ancient Kemet. So it has this chronological order of all of the pharaohs. And it goes from the first intermediate period to the Middle Kingdom, Second intermediary is just all of the dynasties in chronological order of all of the different pharaohs. And then it has color pictures in it, like I said. Really, really dope. So if you are a student of history, make sure you get this book.
Now, an internet marketer told me that there's at least £4,000 worth of information in that book. And he was trying to come with a way of how could it be marketed to do this. Now, who here has done my courses based on the book? No doubt some people in the chat must have done them. And do you think I should have charged £4,000? Anyway, the Black Secret will be revealed in five phases over the next 18 months, where phase one is life, where we're dealing with medieval Africa. They hit the parts of Africa that Black people still predominate today. And that rollout has happened. That rollout is live. And then our next phase is going to be ancient Africa, dealing with places like Kemet and that kind of thing. Our phase three is going to be global Black people over the last 500 years. Phase four is going to be our business projects, where ultimately, if you are entrepreneurial and you want to become an affiliate, you can do that. And then in subsequent phases, we are going to cover all the updates to the Portland model baseline and in all the areas. So we are going to be dealing with mathematics, science and technology, religion and spirituality, music and literature, art and architecture, business and entrepreneurship, great thinkers in the social sciences, because we think it's important that all of our history and heritage, all of the stuff that we can be using to mass educate the people, we can put it in one accessible place. Now, how do we want the community to engage with us? Well, ultimately, we want 1 million African heritage homes all over the world to subscribe to our program. We want every African heritage university to subscribe to our program. We want entrepreneurial people to sell our program as affiliates. And imagine what 1 million empowered households could achieve.
Brother Robin, I just wanted to quickly say, Brother, are you listening to this? This is a game changer. Come on, King. Carry on, brother. Carry on.
Big respect, sir. So the big question is why is this even necessary? And why did we see the need to put this education program together in the first place? Well, there's a key concept called the principle of manifestation. And what it says is what you believe and think shapes how you feel. How you feel shapes what actions you take. And what actions you take shapes the results that you get. And so as you're trying to progress to success, it's very important that that's a positive feedback loop. Now, what impact does programming have? Well, we've all been programmed from childhood about everything, including our history, and in the case of Black people, our supposed lack of it, by parents, family, friends, school, and the mass media. Therefore, programming leads to thoughts. Thoughts lead to feelings. Feelings lead to actions, and actions lead to results. Now, the question is what are the limits of what most Black people are programmed to know about their history? And is this it? So the question I ask is this. If you don't know any Black history or heritage, you would be teaching your children this. Moreover, you would be campaigning to get the schools to teach your children this. Now you can see that that's a very, very dangerous position. This is why you need to know real Black history and heritage. If Black children are taught this, is anybody surprised when they turn out like this? Hope you're enjoying that graphic right there. Moreover, if non-Black people are taught this, is anyone surprised when they treat Black people like this? What Black children feel like after being taught their ancestors were just slaves, and everybody's pointing at that child in the class. You are the person descended from slaves. You should hang your head in shame. Not only that, when you've got white supremacy in public education, you get uncelebrated contributions by people of color, greatly overestimating the achievements of Europeans, a Eurocentric curriculum, creating a distorted self-concept from a distorted history, and is not just what's taught, but it's also what's not taught that keeps racism alive. And here's an example of how white children are taught supremacy. An article was in the Telegraph called School Twinning Schemes with Third World Countries Creating Neo-Colonialist Children. The article says, thousands of schools across Britain have struck up links with poverty-stricken primaries and secondaries in poor nations. Teachers encourage pupils to write to children overseas and take part in joint projects and internet link-ups to raise awareness of other cultures. But research from Exeter University suggests the projects may leave children with racist and patronizing impressions of foreign countries. So, to summarize what we've said so far, our discussion points are these. How have opportunities to get Black history in primary and secondary schools changed? Well, the changes are these: new books, new writers, new content, and we're already getting that content into the schools. How have opportunities to educate Black adults all over the world in Black history and African heritage changed? We've created an online source to make that happen. And is there a connection between how much of a people's history and heritage is taught and how much respect those people receive from others? You betcha. Okay, so what I want to do right now is I'm going to give people about 15 seconds to get their breath back. And then I'm going to get into my next theme, which is what is new in African heritage. All right. Is the 15 seconds up yet? Okay. We ready for this? All right, strap your seatbelts on. This is going to be an interesting ride. What exactly do I mean by new? Whenever I deal with Black history, a lot of people say, but Robin, didn't Sheikhanta Diop already say that? Robin, didn't John Henrik Clarke already say that? Robin, didn't Chancellor Williams already say that? Robin, didn't John Jackson already say that? Robin, didn't Youssef Ben Yochanan already say that? I'm going to present what these guys didn't say because I build on their work, but I update. And this is some of the information that has been found since their research. So this is what's new. This is what's changing the game. Now, why do so many people look down on African heritage? Well, there was a great scholar from Germany called Jan-Heinz Jahr, and he said two essential cultural achievements were missing in the old Africa, however, architecture and writing. Now, the idea that Africa doesn't have any ancient writings, Mr. Jahn himself partly atoned for this false statement when he issued the brilliant book, Neo-African Literature. But the idea that Africa has no writing and no architecture is still the mainstream perspective. And what I'm going to do is introduce you to some of the new findings in Africa, African heritage and so on. Stuff that you're not gonna find in the Mighty Handfuls books. You're not gonna find this in John Henrik Clarke, Sheikhanta Diop, Chancellor Williams, John Jackson, and Youssef Ben Yochanan. Right, now, in the early Middle Ages, the 7th century, this is 600 and something AD, you've got archaeologists discovering the Cathedral of Granite Columns in Old Dongola. And this was the most important religious building in medieval Nubia. And they found the capitals, which would then stand at the top of the columns. And once they did the research on it, they were able to publish this reconstruction of the Cathedral of the Granite Columns. You can see the front cover of the book, and it's done by the Polish archaeologists. Now, what you're looking at here is architecture in Sudan, 600 AD. That is how Africans in Sudan were going on. Now, they also found window grills from the Cathedral of the Granite Columns, and they found window glass in the Makurian cities of Old Dongola and Hambu Kol. So, what do we know about the capital of medieval Nubia, Old Dongola? Well, from the 7th to the 9th centuries AD, not only did we have the church that I've just shown you, high status houses were built And those high status houses were described in UNESCO General History of Africa. And they said further northwards extend an 8th to 9th century housing complex. The houses discovered here differ in their hitherto unencountered spatial layout, as well as their functional program. And they put in brackets, water supply installation, bathroom with heating systems, and interiors decorated with murals. So let's get this straight. Water supply installations, hot and cold water, glass windows. And this is how we were going on in 7th, 8th, and 9th century Sudan. Are we feeling this? Now, where was all of this? In the medieval period, Nubia consisted of three kingdoms, Nobadia, Makuria, and Alwa. And I've showed you Old Dongola, and I'm going to show you Faras, because Faras Cathedral was discovered, rediscovered, by archaeologists. And when they dug it up, they found it was a very impressive building, but the building was in ruins. And bits of the ruins have been are in the British Museum. Bits of it are in Polish museums. And so what happened was they had to then reconstruct. What did that cathedral look like when you assemble all the bits? And they published this photograph. And this is a cross-section image of the lower portion of the cathedral. And this cross-section image of the upper portion, can you see the dome at the top with the cross on top of the dome? This is how Africans were going on 900 years before St. Paul's Cathedral was built in central London. And then that then is the whole thing restored. Now, staying in medieval Nubia, staying in the same time period, 7th, 8th, 9th centuries, the archaeologists found two Nubian monasteries. And what they did was they assembled it. They then did the CGI reconstruction of, if you put all the bits together, what would you have? And it was done by the Polish. So you're going to see it's in Polish and it's in English. Check this out. So did we know then that Sudanese building technology, again, latrines, toilets. The Songhai Empire of West Africa was at its height in the 16th century. Its capital city was called Gao. But what was found in the capital city of Gao? Dr. Tim Insull of Cambridge University recovered an artifact in 1993, and it was exhibited at the British Museum, and I went to the exhibition. And the caption connected to this artifact read as follows: fragments of alabaster window surrounds and a piece of pink window glass, Gao, 10th to 14th centuries. In other words, here we have a second place in Africa with glass windows between the 10th and the 14th centuries. Now, one interesting question might be, how many other cities in the world at that time could boast that its buildings had glass windows? Now, here we've got an aerial view of the city of Timbuktu showing its medieval 2- and 3-story houses and the Great Mosque, which is the building in the foreground. And here we have the Great Mosque. And can you see it looks like a castle? So what have we got? We've got castles, we've got glass windows, we've got bathrooms, we've got toilets. Now, the full development of Western Sudanic architecture, which is the style of architecture of the West African deserts, was at its height in the city of Jenne. And Jenne has the 11th century palace, which then became the 13th century mosque, which is in the center of the photograph. And as you can see, it's a castle. And then you've got the 2- and 3-story houses, which date back to the 15th century, all over the city. And the modern Malians are very proud of the Great Mosque of Jenne, which began life as an 11th century palace. And they've got models of it in the Bamako Museum. I took those photographs. Now, what about the 2- and 3-story houses? Well, let's read it. Plans of the ground floor A, second floor B, and rooftop terrace of an adobe house in Jenne. And on the ground floor, you can see the different rooms. On the second floor, certain rooms. And on the rooftop terrace, you can see salanga, brackets, latrine. Are we feeling this? Toilets in West Africa on the terrace floor. Are we feeling this?
Shut the front door. The front door.
All right, now, Mr. Mohammed, I think you're going to like this bit, right? While we are still in ignorance of our history, this is what others are doing with our heritage. Now, where's that? That's in Fréjus, France, 1930.
Stop it.
Where's this? This is in Disneyland, Florida. Are you feeling this?
Yes.
Where's this? This is in Torremolinos, Spain.
My God, brother.
Where's this? This is the Museum of African Art, Jeju-do, South Korea. Just let that sink in. In fact, the key question is, aren't you embarrassed that there are people in South Korea who know more about your heritage than you do? Let that sink in. In fact, just so we can see that again. Are we feeling that? Are we feeling that? All right, now, where next? The Yoruba civilization in what is today Nigeria was about 600 AD to 1300 AD. And the Benin Empire, also Nigeria, its good period was 1450 to 1650. And Ife, located in southern Nigeria, was the capital, was called Ile Ife, founded in the 6th century. And in the 12th century, the ruler lived in a palace made of enameled brick and decorated with porcelain tiles. And it was built using a technique called impluvium architecture, which, by the way, is the same architectural techniques used to build the Roman city of Pompeii. All right, now let's see what impluvium architecture looks like. You can see here a Yoruba plan of a palace, and you can see the various courtyards, and you can see that there are hundreds of rooms grouped around the courtyard. So the palace itself has got hundreds of rooms. And that one is the Afin, which is Yoruba for palace in the city of Owo. And the 12th century palace, this is what it looked like at the beginning of the 20th century. You can see it's in ruins, but you can see that there are people standing up right next to the doorways. And you can see that's a 3-story structure. Are we feeling this? And that's that 12th century palace in ruins in the city of Ife. Now, when I showed this structure to a Yoruba priestess, she blew her head off. She didn't know that her people were building outlandish grand monuments like this. So what do we know about Benin architecture? This is now, we're moving on in time. This is between 1450 and 1650.
Anyway, name the largest single man-made structure on the planet.
Falling for that one.
No way. No way!
Is it going to be a 50-mile-long tunnel or a bridge or something like that?
Well, what we've got out of the way, because it's hanging here like a worry, is it's not the Great Wall of China.
Oh, OK. Yeah.
Try a continent where it might be.
Europe.
OK.
Europe is not where it is.
Asia.
Australia. Nor Asia, nor Australia.
Okay. North America.
Nor North America.
South America.
Nor South America.
Antarctica.
Antarctica. Nor Antarctica.
No.
Russia.
Africa. Oh.
Africa!
Thank you. I'm really, really hope Ban Ki-moon isn't watching this one.
Africa! Africa!
So is it an Egyptian? Is it North?
It's Nigeria, in fact.
Oh.
It's great earthworks of Benin.
Yeah.
Sometimes called the walls of Benin.
The
walls
of Benin.
Defensive
earthworks. Earthen walls of Benin in...
dug by the Edo people. 10,000 miles in length.
10,000
miles.
By the Edo.
10,000 miles in length.
How could I forget?
Yeah, I know. 4 times longer than the Great Wall of China.
OK.
Teeny little wall.
Consumed 100 times more material than the Great Pyramid of Cheops. Took 700 years and an estimated 150 million hours of digging. Severely damaged by the British, when we sacked and burned Benin in 1897.
Aren't the British?
Yes.
Right, so what did we learn? It's in the Guinness Book of Records, the largest earthenwork structure in the world carried out prior to mechanical times is the 10,000 miles worth of walling in the capital city of the Benin Empire. And this was done in the Nigeria region. Now, where next? I've shaded in an area of a civilization called Mossi. And there was a travelogue where someone visited Mossi and visited the next door kingdom called Kong. On a modern map, Mossi and Kong, one is Burkina Faso in West Africa. Kong is Côte d'Ivoire or Ivory Coast. And they drew this. That's one of the images in the book where we're visiting Mossi and Kong. So did we know Africans were building stuff like this? And this. And this. You see, the idea of a walled city, we thought that that was some European thing, maybe Asian thing. Did we know that this is how we were going on? Three-story buildings. I have no idea what on earth that is. That is some grand building. It looks like probably a mosque, something like that. And hope you're sitting down for this one. In the same travelogue, the author drew the inside of an African iron smelting and steel smelting factory. Are we feeling this? Are we feeling this? Right, where next? The Ashanti Empire. Now, the Ashanti capital city was called Kumasi. And as you can see, the buildings in Kumasi, the standard ones are 2 stories high. More 2-story buildings. This one's a 1-story structure. And let's read a description when Thomas Bowditch visited there in 1817. And we read, what surprised me most about the people of Kumasi and is not the least of their many circumstances deciding their great superiority over the generality of Negroes, was the discovery that every house had its cloquet. Cloquet is toilet, besides the common ones for the lower orders without the town. They were generally situated under a small archway in the most retired angle of the building, but not infrequently upstairs. Within a separate room, like a small closet, where the large hollow pillar also assists to support the upper story. The holes are of a small circumference, but dug to a surprising depth, and boiling water is daily poured down, which effectually prevents the least offense. So the boiling water being poured down kills the smell. And the result then is two-story buildings with a toilet in its own room on the upper story. Are we feeling this? The Palace of Kumasi, this is an example of Fanti architecture. The Fantis are another ethnic group in the Ghanaian region. The Ashantis are one group, the Fantis are another, and it is they who built that three-story structure. So what was inside the palace? I came across a book called The Story of the Ashanti Campaign, 1874, by William Winwood Reed, and this is what he says. First, we went to the king's palace, which consists of many courtyards, each surrounded with alcoves and verandas, and having two gates or doors, so each yard was a thoroughfare. These doors were secured by padlocks. An ordinary house is one courtyard. A large house, three or four. The king's palace had 10 or 12, but the part of the palace fronting the street was a stone house, Moorish in its style, such as those that are built at Cape Coast, with a flat roof and a parapet and suites of apartment on the first floor. It was built by Fanti masons many years ago. The rooms upstairs reminded me of Wardour Street. Yes, that Wardour Street in central London in Soho. Let's read on. Each was a perfect old curiosity shop. Books in many languages, Bohemian glass, clocks, silver plate, old furniture, Persian rugs, and Kidderminster carpets. So where was the Swahili Confederation? All the way along the East African coast, from Mogadishu in Somalia, down to Malindi and Lamu in Kenya, the coast of Tanzania, the coast of Mozambique, and the people, the northerners, were called Berbers, and we are told that means blacks. I know it doesn't mean that today, but that meant it then. The southerners were called Zenj, and they were extremely black in complexion with tattoo marks cut into their faces, and the resulting population were known as the Swahili. So what did their houses look like?
Lamu was just one of many Swahili towns, built in coral stone all the way along the coast from Somalia down to Mozambique. The domestic architecture of Lamu has been no mere copy of the styles of Arabia or India.
From the outside of a traditional Swahili house, there's really nothing to see except a blank wall and a porch with benches for receiving guests. And even when the handsome front doors are opened, there's still only a blank wall behind them. But once inside, it's a very different story. Six or 700 years ago, when houses like this one first began to be designed and built by Swahili architects for leading men and merchants, there were few houses anywhere else in the world so well designed for comfortable city life.
So let's get this straight. That is how East Africans were going on back in the day. So I visited Kenya and I explored the ruins of the palace in Kenya. And the palace has 54 rooms, 11 courtyards, 7 burial areas, and toilets. What do you mean toilets? Okay, here's my, you know, tourist guide. And this scene is called Gedi. I know you can't read it, so I'm gonna blow it up for you. The buildings were constructed of coral rag, coral lime and earth, and some have pictures incised into the plaster finish of their walls, though many of these have deteriorated in recent years. The toilet facilities in the houses are particularly impressive, generally in a double cubicle style with a squat toilet in one and a washstand in the other where a bowl would have been used. Fancier versions even have double wash basins with a bidet between them. All right, so if we were summarizing what we've said so far, we've talked about new developments and discoveries in African architecture in Central Africa, East Africa, West Africa. And these findings have changed the game beyond where the mighty hand fall, the Sheikh Anta Diops, the Yusuf Ben Yochanans, the John Jacksons, the Chancellor Williams, and the John Hendrick Clarks left the game. Okay, so in my last few minutes, I want to talk about the Black Secret Education Project. And there are three reasons why we study our history. The first is to confront limiting beliefs. The second reason is to build a team. You see, every Black person has to see value in other Black people. And the only way we can see value is when we look at our heritage. And then that's when we see that we need each other and we need to work with each other. A third reason why we do our history is so we've got something to comfort this child. You know, what Black children feel like after being taught their ancestors were just slaves. Everyone's pointing at that boy. He's the one descended from slaves. Well, how are you going to comfort that child? What are you going to tell them? And our content gives you the content so you know what to tell them. Now, when you learn your history, it makes you mentally stronger. After all, do you want to spend all your adult life living like this, Black people after work? Are we enjoying that graphic? So who's this? Okay, you could call him Malcolm Little, Detroit Red, Charlestown State Prisoner, 22,843, a student of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, Minister Malcolm X, El-Haj Malik El-Shabazz. Now, what happened? Now, Detroit Red's actions were drug dealing, burglary, gambling, racketeering, robbery, and pimping. His results landed him in prison. But what was his programming? What was his thoughts? What were his feelings? No doubt he was taught this, and it ended up like this. In prison, Malcolm X read widely, which changed his programming and thoughts. In his own words, the Norfolk Prison Colony's library was in the school building. A variety of classes was taught there. Available on the prison library shelves were books on just about every general subject. And this is a snippet of what he learned. And in those days, there was a fabulous fabled city of Timbuktu. Timbuktu was a center of learning, where they had colleges and universities. And this Timbuktu existed as a hidden city or forbidden city to the white man for many centuries. And then with a new programming and thoughts, his feelings also changed. He wrote, "It's a crime, the lie that has been taught to generations of Black men and white men both, little innocent Black children born of parents who believed that their race had no history. Innocent Black children growing up, living out their lives, dying of old age, and all of their lives ashamed of being Black." So how did his actions and his results change? Well, he went from this to this.
Just 10 years ago on the African continent, our people were colonized. They were suffering all forms of colonization, oppression, exploitation, degradation, humiliation, discrimination, and every other kind of Asian. And in a short time, they have gained more independence, more recognition, more respect as human beings than you and I have. And you and I live in a country which is supposed to be the citadel of education, freedom, justice, democracy, and all of those other pretty sounding words. So it was our intention to try and find out what was our African brothers doing to get results so that you and I could study what they had done and perhaps gain from that study or benefit from their experiences. And my traveling over there was designed to help to find out how. One of the first things that the independent African nations did was to form an organization called the Organization of African Unity. The purpose of our organization of Afro-American Unity, which has the same aim and objective, to fight whoever gets in our way. To bring about the complete independence of people of African descent here in the Western Hemisphere and first here in the United States, and bring about the freedom of these people by any means necessary.
So the big questions for each of you are these. How dramatically will your actions change when you master your history and heritage? How dramatically will your newfound knowledge of self skyrocket your own results? Would you like to feel the giant within? Therefore, you must get all you can from the Black Secret Education Program. Here's the biggest question. Imagine if 1 million households and every Black university had access to this material. How many Malcolm X's could we produce? So what should you do next? Well, go to our website, www.theblacksecret.co.uk, and subscribe. So how much is it? Is it £4,000? Is it even 400? Although it would be worth every penny. It is just £35 per month. But we do have a special offer, and the special offer right now is £15 per month early bird. And you've got access to all of our content and all of our future content as well. All lessons presented with convenient bite-sized chapters, downloadable content, including course notes, image slides. We're gonna create the Black Secret student community and fun quiz questions to teach yourself, and the information is in filmed classroom lecture style. And we have a free gift whether you join us or not. We're giving away 100 Black History Facts. We're going to give that away. And again, you need to get on our site if you want to get our free book, 100 Black History Facts. So what have we learned about new teaching resources available for supplementary primary and secondary schools? How Candace Chimbiri is changing the game, how Tony Warner is changing the game, how our team, including Vanika Marshall, is changing the game. The first online Pan-African teaching resource for Black history and African heritage available all over the world for the first time. And as you can see at the bottom of my page, www.theblacksecret.co.uk. And the new developments in African heritage, new developments that you're not going to find in the scholarship of the Mighty Handful. As much as I salute the Mighty Handful, the game has moved on, and this generation is moving it forward. So thank you very much, and this concludes the presentation.
Brothers and sisters, come on, man. Nearly 500 of you have laptops on the platform. Come on, man. Master teacher has spoken. Master, what a history class, man. What a journey. Drop the ones, drop the fives. Let us know if you enjoyed it. Let us know if you've learned something, man. This is the Hidden Truth platform. Wow. Every week, brothers and sisters, understand this. We bring the best of the best of the best. Robin, we bow to you, King. That was a masterclass in such beautiful fashion with such a great spirit, man. Absolutely amazing. Absolutely amazing. Brothers and sisters, come on. Show the love. Show the love, man. It's a new day. Things are moving. Every week you come on this platform, you're talking about people who are doing some phenomenal worldwide movements, worldwide master moves. Brother Robin, once again, King, may Allah continue to bless you, man. We love your angle. We love your spirit. We love the way you give pure knowledge, wisdom and understanding, and laying down the truth and giving the evidence behind it, brother. Once again, we bow to you, King. Is there any last words you want to say?
Yeah, thank you for having me on your show. Big up to Leon Marshall, the scientist. Big up to Taki of the HAPI film. Big up to everybody, and hope people enjoyed the session and got a lot out of it. And again, it's www.theblacksecret.co.uk. Thank you.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. And you know, brothers and sisters, you know, it's just been such a phenomenal night. I'm gonna do something very, very silly. Robin, are you there, King?
Yes, sir.
Let's have a look. Brothers and sisters, you know, I don't want the brother to take it from myself. Raise your hand. Raise your hand If you'd like to give verbal feedback to Robin based on what you heard tonight or based on the work that he's done that's inspired you, raise your hand. I'm only going to take one or two very quick people. Raise your hand as we go towards the conclusion of our show. Raise your hand if you'd like to say any words to Robin Walker, because you know what? It's a new day, brothers and sisters. Wow, hands are being thrown in. I'm only going to go to one or two. I'm sorry. I've only got space for one or two because of time. Sister Tian. Sister Tian, can you unmute yourself, Sister Tian? Literally, a few quick words, my queen. If you're not, I'm going to move on because time has gone. Sister Eve. Sister Eve, could you unmute yourself, please, if you'd like to say any words? Oh, Sister Eve, yes.
Yes, thank you so much. Thank you so much. I have done Robin's courses before, but I must say this was amazingly stimulating. It was full of so much more hope, given what we've all gone through in the last couple of years. And it was so encouraging. Having working with young people, I can just see how this can change people's lives phenomenally. So I just want to say thank you so much for the relentless work that you do. You're inspiring people all over the world, and we all need to share this. Thank you.
Eve, I love the way you speak, sister. Concise and straight to the point. Love that, love that, love that, Sister Eve. One love for that, sister. I'm going to move. Is that Sister Tian?
It is.
Okay.
Robin, I can't thank the whole team enough, actually, for your humbleness, for your service to our community, for the elevation, for helping us all to aspire and inspire us. And the fact that you're actually doing this on an international footprint now, we can only but imagine that the sky is truly the limit. It is truly the limit. Thank you so much. We salute all of you.
Thank you. Jan? Thank you.
Fantastic. Sister Raminta. Sister Raminta, please, a few words if you like. Sister Raminta.
Can you hear me?
We can, sister.
Oh, I'm just so awed. I don't. It was absolutely brilliant. Thank you so much. Thank you, thank you, thank you. I have got the book. I think way, way back when it was published, when we ruled, and it's just unbelievable, the information in there. Brilliant. I've just done the membership as well. So thank you, thank you, thank you, Robin. Thank you,
sister. One love to you every time, brother Adrian. What would you like to say? Very quickly, Brother Adrian, what would you like to say? Unmute yourself, my king. The Black History Man is right in front of you right there. I'm going to move on. Anyone takes too long, we're going to be moving on. Sister Heather, what would you like to say, my queen? Sister Heather.
Hello, Brother Andrew. Thank you for bringing on fire presenters as ever. Thank you, Robin Walker, for your amazing work. I first did your course to introduce When We Ruled about 15 years ago at the GLA, and you're as impressive now as you were then. And I was distracted with some of the compliments up to now because I've just been registering for the course, which I've done. Thank you again.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Sister Heather, Robin, I want you to drink some of this in, Brother Robin. I want you to drink this in. Sister Marcia Anderson. Sister Marcia Anderson, would you like to unmute yourself very quickly, my queen? Sister Marcia Anderson, could you unmute yourself very quickly, my queen?
Greetings. That was fantastic. I'm so overjoyed that Robin Walker is doing this. I was also a student a good 15 years or so, and I was actually inspired because of the amount of information to set up my own documentary school here in Birmingham called Children of the Sun, going for 7 years now. This course, this secret, this black secret community, I can't wait to be a part of it. My daughter is signing me up as we speak, so I'm looking forward to more growth. And as Robin, as we all know, this is going to be a game changer for us as a people globally. So
thank
Robin,
you.
I thank you, Brother Andrew. Thank you for this wonderful platform as well. I'm here.
Pure love. Oh, sorry, sister. Oh, my God. Sorry. I didn't realize the sister was still talking. Sister, forgive me. Forgive me. Forgive me, sister. I didn't realize. I thought you'd finish. Brother Robin, it's just been an amazing night, brother. Is there anything you'd like to say to those few people that just spoke to you?
No. I mean, big up to Marcia, big up to the positive feedback, and hope people got a lot out of it, and keep doing your thing. Keep, you know, I'll keep on keeping on, and stay strong, everybody, you know.
Oh, brother Robin, you're so humble, brother. You are so humble. That's one of your trademarks, brother. Brothers and sisters, I know there's other people that put their hands up. Apologies. Because of time, we couldn't, you know, stay on the line. But brothers and sisters, I just wanted to make sure that you, some of you had a chance to give back to the man of the moment. It's been a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful night, brothers and sisters, as we go through. As I said, you're with the Investigator of Hidden Truth. We've still got nearly 500 of you on the platform with laptops. I can't wait to find out how many of you in total are on this platform listening to my beautiful brother, Robin Walker. You're with your boy, the Investigator of Hidden Truth. And you know what? This has been a fantastic night. We had brother Leon Marshall dropping phenomenal tap dancing education, brothers and sisters, with humor, but with serious power. And obviously, we had our beautiful brother, Robin Walker, man, the Black History Man, one of the most humblest men that's in this game, one of the most true to the game brothers, man. Doesn't speak about himself, but he's just so awesome. Brother Leon Marshall, we salute you, my king. Fantastic teachings. And as we said, brother and sisters, make sure you get the book, Hidden Science of Melanin. It's worldwide. Brother's going around the country signing copies right now. We want to give a shout out to Sister Kim. Sister Kim Thompson. Come on, man. She kicked off the show tonight with a fantastic organization, United We Rise. I want that sister back on the platform because we've got lots of work to do together. She's got a fantastic team. And make sure you get hit her website and get onto that. Let's not forget Bubba Leon Ostrong, beloved, the up-and-coming UK brother who's literally killing the filming industry, an award-winning artist in the film, in the world of directing. This brother's brought out one of the few Black British Horror Movies. And guess what? Helped to be financed by you on Hidden Truth. You helped finance it so that the brother can literally employ people from our own community to keep that work going. Don't forget the 27th of May, tickets are free. Make sure we get our tickets for that night. Let's not forget we touched base with New York City. Tarki Grant, brothers and sisters, another film director and organizer of the One Africa Power in Unity Conference. You're getting this all on one platform, brothers and sisters, all on one platform. That is what Hidden Truth's about. Don't forget, next week, brothers and sisters, Reclaiming Me. Come on, man, self-healing. The journey towards a positive self. We've got our sister Samira. We've got our sister Danielle, and this is for brothers and sisters. And I'm telling you now, brothers and sisters, we've got some blockbusters coming back onto this platform. Wait and see. Don't forget next week, Reclaiming Me. And brothers and sisters, please, let's not forget. Brothers, we want you to stand up. I only need a few of you to join me at my Saturday Academy. And I want us to do some work of our youth on that day. I'm calling to brothers, Black men on this platform. If you want to work with Brother Andrew Muhammad and my team at Westside Young Leaders Academy, email me on investigator37@hotmail.com. investigator37@hotmail.com. Let me know about yourself, okay, brothers and sisters, brothers, and maybe you'll be chosen to come and touch base with some of my students. I'm sorry, we can't have all of you, but there's a few that we you know that can roll with us, and we're planning bigger things down the later part of this year. Sisters, I'm going to say to you now, sisters, the week after we're doing the same thing for the sisters. So sisters, if you're interested in working with some of our young girls, some of our young princesses, you got to email me too. But that's not for the 14th. That's going to be the following week, and we're going to be blowing up. We are serious on this platform. We're talking about community change. It starts here on the Hidden Truth platform, brothers and sisters. We're going to not just stop. We're not going to be listening on a Tuesday every single week. We're going to roll up our sleeves and go to work in our community. If you really are serious about making community change, on this platform, you can join Brother Andrew Mohammed and the whole of my team, and let's start making the word flesh. Brothers and sisters, don't forget, we want to thank all of you that have been donating to the works of the Westside Young Leaders Academy and the Lewisham Young Leaders Academy. Remember, if you are donating, email me directly yourself, not just for praise. I want to know, we've got an admin department. Yes, we have got an administration department. But when you're donating on via our bank credit system, we can't see your email address. We can't phone you to thank you. I want you to email me. And I want to take responsibility to make sure we want to thank you for your support on us, brothers and sisters, so that when we do special events, I personally will invite you to show you so you can meet the children that you're supporting. Because I've got to be transparent. I don't want no one saying, Brother Andrew stole my money. I gave my money to this cause and we never saw anything come out of it. Hell no. My name is very important in this community. And I don't want no one can say after 40 years of me working for the Black community, no one, I'm going to say this again, no one can say, Brother Andrew thief my money. I've got 40 years working on this platform, brothers and sisters, and hell no. No one can say Brother Andrew came and stole my money, yeah? So brothers and sisters, I don't intend to steal your money today, yeah? None of you have got enough money to buy me, none of you. But I want to show you my thanks for supporting and walking with me on this path. Brothers and sisters, this is the Hidden Truth platform. Still got over 400 of you on this platform. And you know what comes next. You know.
What would be the best music ever? Old school reggae. Do I really need to explain?
No, no, no. Sweet. Yeah. Oh, man, girl, and they give it sweet. Hey, gringos and pasero. How are you make way for the bandolero? I'll be down by the river.
I'm a living while I'm living to the Father I will pray.
Hey, me and my friend Z on the NZ.
Buffalo soldier.
Ring the alarm, and not a sound is dying.
We lick the chalice, make the water go.
Brother Dean Mohammed has just typed, I love the Hidden Truth family. Dean, I challenge you, brother. I challenge anyone to love the Hidden Truth family the way that I love the Hidden Truth family. Brothers and sisters of Hidden Truth, you are making a change in the UK and around the world. That's why Hidden Truth is so successful, because I don't know, man, you always seem to support this platform. You support Sister Samira. You support Lady Adele. You support Sister Jurita. You support Brother Chef Kev. You support Lady and my little daughter, China, the investigator. We've got a great team that works on behalf of you. And brothers and sisters, we want to thank you. We want to thank you. And I know many of you now want to say, Andrew, settle yourself now and bring on Sister Samira to make sure she nice up the place. Sister Samira, are you there? Are you there? DJ Samira, jeez, you're done though. She's got her DJ platforms on today, but next week she's going to be one of the speakers, and you know she don't play. She don't play. Very articulate, with a fantastic spirit of love to her community. Sister Samira, lick shot from Babylon Queen. It's all yours.
Oh, thank you so much, Brother Andrew. And before we get into the after party and the fun, if I may just thank every single person that I don't even know